Hey guys, how's it going? I hope you're having a great day. Today's Allcraft video is sponsored by the developers of Black Desert Online. So thank you guys so much for supporting the streams and the content. I really, really appreciate it. I want to introduce you guys real quick to Black Desert Online. Black Desert Online is a massive online multiplayer game created in Korea. And ever since it's been created, it has amassed a huge player base. It has several components that allow you to immerse yourself in the game, such as great graphics, weather changes, and lots of dynamic game settings that just make the game feel pretty good. If you guys would like to try out the game, the developers have given me a 7 free day trial code that you guys can just get if you press the link down below. So you guys can give Black Desert Online a try. They actually released a new class called the Male Archer. You guys can also give it a try. And like I said, I want to thank you guys all for supporting Allcraft. Thank you so much again, Black Desert, for supporting the show. Make sure to click the link down below and check out the game. Really appreciate it. And with that said, let's get into Allcraft.
Oh, that's hot. That's hot.
First Allcraft of a brand new year, and we decided we had to just get together, the three of us that have been on the show for like 30 years now, and talk about what's going on in WoW. And also we wanted to make sure that we could talk to you guys more. The Q&A's have been absolutely, we've been overwhelmed by the amount of questions that we've been getting recently, and we kind of had the advantage. You know, the developer Q&A's have been happening left and right, but it's really hard to kind of sit down for them and answer all the questions for obvious reasons. For us, we can do whatever the heck we want, so we figured we'd sit down, look at as many questions as possible, and really get through them while still trying to talk about some of the problems that are happening in World of Warcraft. So if you haven't submitted a question yet, go ahead and do that. We're going to go through all the questions that we just got today and maybe even go back and look at some older ones and talk about it. But before we do that, we should probably just kind of open up with the general state of World of Warcraft right now. Asmund, we were talking about it during the call while Hada was getting everything set up. There are quite a few problems that I think we need to touch upon today.
Well, I think right now, I mean, obviously, you know, and this happens with every end period between raid tiers, is because everybody knows that Mythic Plus dungeons are going to be scaled up whenever the raid comes out. Everybody knows that PvP gear is going to be scaled up whenever the raid comes out. Everything is going to be scaled up whenever the raid comes out. So almost everyone right now that's still playing is probably just waiting for the raid to come out and doing other things that aren't necessarily advancing their player power, right? Farming mounts, doing other random stuff, and just general things like that. That's at least what I'm doing. Well, that's always what I do, but that's what I'm doing now as well. And I think most people are just kind of waiting for that reset basically to happen, because a lot of people might not realize this, but we're going to be going up. Everybody's item level is probably going to be going up somewhere around 30 item levels or so, 15 to 30 item levels, depending on how geared you are to how lucky you are in patch 8.1 with like the raid coming out. All of your gear is going to get replaced. Like everything is getting replaced. And I don't really know how to feel about that, but it is going to be pretty intense.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of where I'm at as a player right
yeah.
now. I feel like actually getting on and doing mythic, like I was doing so many mythic dungeons before the raid tier was actually kind of announced, and we knew it was coming out. We knew that we were going to get a big power bump. And now I'm like, wait, why would I do keys? Like, even if I am logging on to an alt that my group that I typically run stuff with is like, yeah, we're going to funnel you gear. It's like, well, what's the point? We can just funnel me gear in like a month, or not a month, 2 weeks now, 3 weeks now. And we can funnel that gear at the end of the month. And then all of a sudden, I can just bypass all of this. That's one of the problems with the rubber banding, is as a player, you sit there and you don't really see a motivation.
Well, that's the problem, right? And this is something that that BFA struggles with a lot. And I think Legion struggled with towards the end of its expansion cycle too, is how can you motivate players to do something that they know is going to get replaced in an arbitrary period of time? And I think the issue now is that whereas before, like, and I'm talking like Wrath of the Lich King, Burning Crusade, vanilla days, you had the motivation to get your character geared up so you would be prepared for the content that's coming out whenever the new patch comes out. But now, because everything is functionally reset for every player, there is no motivation that players have to kind of get ready for the new patch, because the patch gets you ready on its own.
Some people are saying you can collect Residuum, and that's not really how it seems like it's going to function.
It's not fun. Like, why would anybody want to do that?
Well, the thing is you sit there as a player and you don't really have that motivation, even though like the main motivation that you kind of know is actually going to functionally increase your character's power level is getting artifact power or whatever the heck it's called at this point, Azerite, for your neck. Because that's the one thing where, you know, okay, at this point, it's going to activate these traits. I know that I'm going to get that power bump. With Residuum, there are so many questions, and like values and things like that have kind of not been given to the public. And it seems like they're almost waiting to say, okay, this is going to be the Residuum value for this type of gear based off of player behavior. And that doesn't let players behave the way that they would if they had full information. Obviously, you're kind of, it's like a chicken and egg scenario, but you're affecting player behavior by waiting for player behavior to happen.
Yeah. Well, they're also intentionally not telling people things. And I think probably the best example of this is the Amonthul's trinket. Is they didn't tell anybody about how the Amonthul's trinket was going to work. And I think you'd have to be a delusional idiot to think that the player base would actually be happy with the idea that an extremely powerful legendary trinket that drops off of the last boss in the game will be randomly assigned to a player at a 1% ratio whenever you kill the boss. Like, nobody would be happy about that. And they told people, well, just wait and see. And the reason they said that is so they wouldn't have to deal with the frustration before it happened, and they could just have positivity for the patch, and then people would complain about it later on. And that's what they're doing, right? Is they oftentimes disguise and don't tell people about the negative aspects of these systems that are focused on player hours and not necessarily enjoyment hours until the systems are already in the game and they become explored and understood by players. Another example of this is the Mythic Plus dungeon box at the beginning of BFA. Now, Blizzard said that they had changed the Mythic Plus dungeon box at the in the beta, right, for BFA to drop only one item, because it used to drop from one to three items, but then they changed it to only drop one item guaranteed, and there would never be a chance to get two or three items like there is now. And players were playing the game, and there would never be a way that you could accurately test that you were not able to get two or three items anymore, because you could always just say that you were unlucky. And because the sample size was so small in the beta with people completing Mythic Plus dungeons, and you had a limited time to do it because you only could do it once a week, there would be no way to accurately dictate that you would not be able to get two or three items. And Blizzard waited until players did the Mythic Plus dungeons to tell them that, because it's obviously not something that the players wanted to hear. And it's very frustrating that Blizzard has that response to dealing with the negative aspects of their systems, rather than putting those negative aspects out there first and letting players know, this is what the system is going to be, this is what it's going to entail, and then letting the negative feedback dictate and educate them and inform them on how they want to develop the game in the future. And that way it won't happen to even go live in the beginning.
Hotted. I remember to go back to what kind of sparked that right now when Asmongold's talking about that Amonthul's trinket. I remember when we actually talked about it on the show, and there were so many questions about it, Hotted, about like, how is it going to drop? And I think what we actually heard in a developer Q&A, which is definitely in line with what the theme of our episode is tonight, was, you're going to like how it drops. It was something in the area of that. So I feel like none of us probably did. And Hada, that was quite some time ago. Do you feel like that's kind of an attitude that's been given to us with some of the other systems that are currently being released right now in BFA?
Well, as far as the systems that are being released right now with the Residuum vendor, I wish, I'm not exactly sure, I haven't joined the PTR at the public test room, but we exactly don't know how much a certain value item of the Azerite gear is going to cost, correct?
It's in the game right now.
The new one?
I mean, so you can tell. Yeah, you know how much it's going to be.
Well, the actual values now are leaked, to my knowledge, but they're not confirmed, is where I was last time I checked with Residuum. And this is the main problem with me, and currently with the game, is I can't make myself give a flying hoot, because it's such a... I think the only thing that I made myself care about recently was switching all of my tunes to engineering, because the helm is so good. Like that's the only thing where I was like, okay, this is a concrete power level. If I'm going to be able to craft the helm as quickly as possible, I know that I'll have a high level of Azurite gear, and that's that. I can't make myself grind the neck because it just seems arbitrary, and the power level feels like crap. I ultimately will get it by playing eventually, and I'll play when it actually. Yeah, I said hoot. I'm sorry, guys. Demonetized. I ruined everything.
I actually was talking to Scott, came and visited me in Berlin for New Year's, and I was talking to him while he was doing dailies on my while he was doing his Azurite power quest, Artifact power quest, because I asked him straight up, like, how much is the increase in power of leveling his neck? And he just told me, the only reason he is leveling his neck, obviously, is because of the raid tier sets. So it's not even about how much more power you're going to get from the neck itself. It's just straight up to unlock some of the trade items from gear, which is, I don't know, like I think the whole trade system is obviously, like we've discussed it several times, is not in the right state, in my opinion. Well,
here's what they could do, right? I mean, because they already basically said everything but the fact that Azurite traits will pretty much be unlocked in 8.2 for everything, right? I mean, that's pretty much what they've said. And if they're going to do that, like, why are they waiting until 8.2 to do this? Like, why not? The raid's not going to come out for a while. Just make the power levels or the Azurite levels of the new raid tier stuff be the exact same as the current raid tier stuff. Yeah. And it'll be done. They could literally do that in a hotfix. And this is just another example of more artificially gated content and them holding back changes that are obviously quality of life changes for some arbitrary period in the future because they want people to continue playing with a dog shit system that nobody wanted from the beginning.
You know, I take notes before every show, right? And it's just a general guide of questions that I want to ask you guys and that I want to ask our guests. And you kind of know the direction of the show before we actually start every night. And the only really big note that I had tonight, obviously, because we're going to focus on taking questions from everybody who's watching, was should this patch have even come out? Should it have even been released? And honestly, my opinion to start things off, which I don't typically do, is no, I don't think that this patch should have been released at all. I think it was a huge mistake. I think it was an empty patch. And I think it would have been much better if we even just waited and the game felt as dead as it does right now, as far as content goes, because it does feel relatively empty, and just got the patch when the raid tier actually came out. I think I would feel less like what is going on with the game if they waited to actually release it, maybe next week or the week after that. So, do you guys feel the same way or do you completely disagree?
I would disagree with you on there, but I also don't disagree with you on the pacing of the patch. I think the patch should have been released with BFA. Let's be honest. The game feels much more complete with 8.1. If they had released the game with 8.1, everything in 8.1 came out on release of BFA, I think the reception of the game would have probably been substantially better. Like, I'm not saying it would have been great, but it would have been substantially better. And their failure to do that and the idea of releasing an incomplete expansion and then releasing an incomplete patch to fix the incomplete expansion that will be fixed later on, which is conveniently slightly more than a month until after the patch comes out. You know, I mean, some of these things are just, I mean, they're so transparent, right?
Yeah,
it becomes boring and it just gives players a jaded sense of being abused and manipulated and everything like that. I don't feel like Blizzard should have postponed the patch. And I think Blizzard should do a better job at fixing problems earlier rather than waiting and making players wait for a long period of time for obvious changes to happen.
Well, and it's we'll also, talk it's about also that. Something yeah. huge that that how much of the percentage of the player base in BFA did this cost in BFA? Like, how much do you think it impacted BFA? Like, I know I've seen countless posts, countless comments, countless tweets saying that they've quit the game. And, like, for people that take that ultimate step and quit, it usually takes quite a bit of time for them to come back or just give the game another chance. It's kind of, like, irreparable.
Well, so I want to read this comment because it's in line with that. And guys, I'm really trying to pay attention tonight to everything that you say. Like, this is focused on what you guys think. We really kind of want to be interacting with you guys because I feel like it's sometimes when we have the guests on, we really want to make sure that everything that the guest is saying is brought to attention and we can focus on their expertise. But tonight, that's kind of why we wanted to just have the three of us. And this is from Kildy in chat. He said, players were bored, though. They had to release the patch or else there would be even less to do. The patch brought in Residuum, Assault, and upgraded Islands and a new Warfront. They needed to give players more to do so they don't unsub in between early December and now. Come on, Rich. Now, the thing is I totally agree with that, but I think a patch is a very powerful thing. Because let's say maybe you don't even unsub, but maybe you get to the place as a player where you say, you know what, I'm going to play something else for a little while, which is currently where I'm at, right? And, you know, I log on, I play a different game. I'm not unsubbed. I'm waiting for the content to come out, and I'm paying very close attention and waiting to come back in. A patch is always that thing that draws you back in. If you are greeted by a patch that isn't strong, that initial first impressions are everything, right? If you see this patch and you don't like it, even though the raid's not out, even though all this stuff is out, I'm going to keep going with my break. I'll wait till the next patch. And that's why I kind of posed that question, because I don't disagree with you. I think that that was the motive of releasing the patch at this pacing, at this clip. Players needed something to do, but I don't feel like they got enough to do in a patch. Well, and that was my major
something that's going to reinforce your point, I think, is that I do not think that it is an accident that so many of these patches have come out and the raid has come out between 45 and 60 days, somewhere around there. And I don't know like an exact date. I think that might be a little bit too specific, but it's come out more than a month after the patch. Now, the cynic in me and the skeptic in me would say, are they doing this in order to get people to subscribe two times whenever a patch is released? I mean, based off of so many transparent and manipulative things they've done recently, I wouldn't put it past them. But what I really think is odd is what you're saying here is that whenever a player does come back to play the patch and they play the patch and they're not getting all their content and they resub for the patch, well, their sub is going to run out before the actual content goes out. Mm-hmm. And what's the chances of them sticking around and saying, well, the game sucks now, but maybe it'll be better in a month again? I think that oftentimes you have players that come back for the patch and they don't get the experience that they should have had, right, with all the content, and they end up unsubbing faster than if all the content was released in the first place.
Now, I'm going to assume that they have a bunch of data that probably supports what they're doing, right? Maybe this actually worked. Maybe this keeps everybody subbed, whether or not they're happy or unhappy. I mean,
they've been using analytics for forever, right? And those analytics drove the game into the ground in Warlords of Draenor. Yeah, right. Yeah. And it drove the game into the ground in Cataclysm and Mists of Pandaria, despite it being a pretty successful expansion in a lot of ways, still lost subs for almost the entirety of the game.
Sorry, which one did?
Mists of Pandaria.
Okay. Sorry.
The only point where it gained subs was once in, I think, patch 5.2 or 5.3. And then again, whenever Warlords of Draenor was released or announced or whatever. Yeah, it was announced. Their analytics are obviously flawed. Like, I mean, you can't have universally negative feedback. Because you look like anywhere, like Reddit, you go into general forums, you go anywhere, there's pretty much universally negative feedback about the game. Their analytics aren't working. They should fire the people that are doing analytics for them, because obviously those people aren't doing their job.
Question about analytics real quick. We all know that Blizzard has been keeping the subscriber numbers a secret, and they don't announce it anymore to the public, to avoid backlash. Is that a right decision to do for the public? Do you think that it would drive more negativity if people knew the subscriber numbers, or is that a way to kind of like shelter the audience?
I think it's the right decision personally, because assholes like us will just sit there and be like, well, look, 10 people unsubbed. Like, even if just a few unsubbed, it's just like it's fuel to be like, the game's bad. If a lot of people unsub, you can say that it's bad. And one of the things with Mists of Pandaria, I actually agree with Asmongold in a lot of ways and think that Mists of Pandaria was a very good expansion. And I think a large part of Mists of Pandaria maybe losing traction throughout the entirety of the expansion wasn't all the game's fault. I don't think MoP was perfect by any stretch of the imagination. It's one of my personal favorite expansions, but I also think that there was a lot going on in gaming at the time, and WoW had lived quite a long life already, that I think that it makes sense that it was losing some traction. I think that there's a new wave for games like World of Warcraft right now. I think the players want to consume stuff like that again. And this is all anecdotal, right? I'm not 100% sure. This is just based off of what I see through my community and through other communities about what people want to play, what people are watching. And I think it's really bad when people do come back to WoW for the first time, and the way that the system is set up is backwards. It is incredibly complicated to get started with no payoff, and the skill ceiling is not very high. Classes aren't fun to play. You're sitting there trying to, you're just scratching your head trying to figure out how the heck Azerite's supposed to work, and the gearing system, the loot system, all the reward systems are empty.
Yeah, I mean, like, that's basically, I think with Mists of Pandaria, like, the game was in a relatively good state, right? And I think Mists of Pandaria had a lot of setbacks. The reason why I dislike Mists of Pandaria, number one, well, I mean, it's hard really for me to say, and I don't want to get into this too much, but it's undeniable that the analytics and everything that Blizzard is using to advance and make decisions are flawed. Like, it's obvious. Like, I mean, the reason why are they not showing subscriber numbers? It's because they're going down. Like, that's why. I mean, let's just cut the bullshit. Do you think that if WoW had 15 million subscribers, Blizzard wouldn't say that? Of course not. Of course they would say that. And it's like they used to literally have a gold star on the box of the games telling you how many people are playing it. Of course they would show it. They stopped showing it at the very, like, at the bottom of where the game was ever at, in like the middle of Warlords of Draenor. So it's not a surprise to, you know, or not, it's not a conspiracy to think that they're intentionally not talking about it because of how bad they could be. That being said, I don't necessarily think that Blizzard should show the subscriber numbers. I don't think so, because whenever the subscriber numbers would go down, everybody would panic and they'd get really mad. And I think that them announcing dropping subscriber numbers caused subscriber numbers to drop more.
Yeah,
and like a domino effect.
Well, yeah. And it's like, does that really help the game? Like, no, it doesn't. And you could say, well, people deserve to know. Number one, they don't deserve to know. And number two, it's not good for the game all in all. Like, I don't think anybody deserves or has the right to know how many people are playing the game. I mean, obviously, people want to know. I want to know how many people are subscribed. But the reason I would want to know is to know if what I think about the game is actually true.
Well,
and I think if the game ever gets better, right, or if it gets worse, everybody uses that and they says, well, that's because of LFR. That's because of Titan Forging. That's because of Mythic Plus. That's because of PvP. And everybody is going to insert their own personal agenda or their own, you know, pet peeves or pet content that they want to emphasize or put down as the reason of the subscriber numbers going up or down.
So you can very easily take it's a problem with statistics, right? You can just confirm your own things if you're not properly using numbers.
It confirms
bias. Exactly. Now, my question for you, though, you talk about the power of potentially people viewing subscriptions going down and being like, I unsubscribe because 10 million other people did it, right? Which does make sense. I think that there is some validity to it. We see a huge amount of increased negative sentiment right now, and this is not an attack on you at all. You're one of my best friends, and I agree with most of your ideas. It's a big reason that I wanted to do the show with you. And when I don't disagree, I see where you're coming from, and I think it's always an interesting conversation. But do you think, being one of the most popular people in World of Warcraft, when you have a negative outlook at all, do you think that that increases the negative sentiment in the community? Do you think that maybe that has the same effect? And I'm not saying that you should be censored at all, but Twitch has created a different climate. Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I mean, if I say the game sucks, people are going to say the game sucks. Like, yeah. I mean, it's not out of the realm of possibility that streamers saying something good or bad about a game is going to influence the way people feel about it. In fact, it's so true that gaming companies will pay streamers thousands of dollars an hour to play their games. That's how important it is. It's literally worth thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars to do that. So even if you think that streamers don't have influence, these massive billion-dollar companies disagree with you. And yeah, I think it does hurt the game. And I don't know, like, really, what am I supposed to do? Do I want the game to die slowly while I just tell everybody that it's great and people suddenly slowly? And also it erodes my own sense of credibility whenever I'm telling somebody something that's plainly a lie. I think one of the issues and the things with live streaming is that you're giving people a more authentic, genuine experience of what you are and who you are and what you think. And I don't want to go on and just pretend. Obviously, I play things up for my stream. Of course I do, because it's fun for me. Yeah. But I'm not going to say that the sky is red when it's actually blue. Okay.
Well, I wanted to bring that up, and because I think it's an important thing to talk about. But when you're saying one of those things where it's like, I haven't streamed in quite a few weeks now, and there are a lot of reasons that I had to take the break for personal reasons and things like that. But I have this anxiety to actually stream WoW right now because I don't feel like myself. And it's like kind of hard to sit there and like, I'm not going to be super positive when I'm playing the game right now. If you saw me being super positive, it wouldn't be true. And I feel like that is an important thing with streaming, is being very genuine. And I think that that's fortunately something that we all have the luxury to do a lot of the time, but it hurts when you are being negative and you want something to succeed and you don't feel like that feedback is also being received.
Also, one other thing that I want to get into is the fact that if anybody ever tells me, you know, or asks me, should I play WoW? I say, WoW is the worst game ever, and it's the best game out there. Yes, start playing WoW. So at the end of the day, I give people the same advice. I'm like, yeah, I love this game. I played this game for over a decade. I really enjoy it. If you like playing games the same way that I do, then you'll probably enjoy it too. And that I don't even say don't play WoW. That's the most interesting thing about it. I just want the game to be better, okay? Like, I really enjoy playing like Dark Souls, and I really have enjoyed playing other games and all, but I'd like to be able to play WoW and feel like I was doing something positive for my stream. And this comes from a purely selfish perspective, but that selfish perspective I feel helps a lot of other people too. Mm-hmm. I want the game to feel compelling and fun and everything, so I can make good streams about it and have a lot of fun with it and everything. It's frustrating to me whenever I look at the content for my stream and the things that do very well, and many of those things are not created by Blizzard, right? Transmog competitions are not created by Blizzard. Malinoff's not Blizzard. DPS competitions, not Blizzard. The Horde City Raids, not supported really by Blizzard at all. And in fact, the opposite, because if you have more than 40 people there, the server's going to break. And all these other examples, right, of things that I do on my stream that transcend the normal content that Blizzard is trying to provide. And I honestly hope that Blizzard looks at some of the content that not only me, but other people too do, and sees ways to incorporate that into the actual game and looks at the psychology behind it and asks themselves, why is this so compelling? And then takes those answers and applies them to the actual game.
Yeah, this is something that I was struggling for like a couple of years. Like Rich said, sometimes lose the drive to find something fun in a game. And I think that the shift in WoW is kind of clear to me. It's really fun when you have specific things to do. For example, arenas with friends, because that's one of the things that I enjoy to do the most. Maybe you go in once or twice a week or three times a week to clear the current raid content. But besides that, I feel like the time that you have to invest in a game, let's say the 40, 50 hours a week that you used to put into World of Warcraft because it was your life and soul besides whatever you did in real life, it's just gone. Like, it's just like specific things to do in the game. And then after you do those things, you can just go ahead and do different things. I guess the shift, there has been a shift in the way how you play the game at the moment. And that's why, for example, I play other games as well on stream, because if I would play World of Warcraft 60, 70 hours a week, I would lose my mind, you know? Like, I would have no idea what to do.
I think one of the things that you're kind of touching upon there is the way that rewards are doled out in the game right now. The way that you're actually given rewards seems weird. And then to take it a step further, I did my first invasion, or whatever the heck they're called, the other day. And I was playing my incursion. Oh, great. And now I feel better about it.
That's
now it's new.
Special kind of invasion.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm doing it right. And I was
can't
playing
call it invasion again, because that's what they had in Legion. These are incursions. They're different.
I was playing my elemental shaman and I was playing my demonology warlock, right? Because these are actually two specs that I'm having fun with. One, because they just tuned it up a shitload. So now playing this spec feels rewarding because it does damage, and demonology because it's something new and it's one of the first, one of the few specs right now that feels like a new rotation, which you typically come to expect in an expansion. But I'm trying to go through and do these quests, and the quests weren't even good. Like, I feel like the quest quality wasn't as high as quest quality typically was too. And like, I'm just walking around with a stupid battering ram. And so even that didn't feel as clean and as polished and as finished as quests typically felt in the past. And that's something that I've never, ever, ever said before. That's never been a huge criticism of mine. And I was pretty surprised by that.
I think mob damage and tuning was higher than it was in Legion. And because of that, I think Blizzard designed questing with a very, very clear time frame in mind that it would take for you to do, you know, X task or Y task. And because it was so tightly tuned, players that were highly skilled or low skilled were not really able, or just wanted to be more inventive, were not really able to step outside the confines of what the normal leveling experience provided and do something a little bit more unique. And I think the best contrast that I can use for this is Warlords of Draenor. Now, for all of the bad things about Warlords of Draenor, one thing that you can't say is that it had bad leveling. Warlords of Draenor had some of the best leveling that we've seen in this game since Wrath of the Lich King, and arguably ever. The questing was completely unique. It was open-ended. You could go to multiple different places. There are multiple different ways that you could do the quest, right? You had bonus objectives. You had treasures. You had rare spawns. You had rare spawns that dropped those quest items. I think that Blizzard should look at Gorgorond as the best questing zone in WoW that has ever been made.
It was definitely...
It's the best, really, period. By the way, that's not even by... That's like, oh, it's just a little bit better than Grizzly Hills or something. No, it's better by a mile. It is just infinitely better than anything that they've ever made before and also have ever made since.
I want to bring this up right now and then dive back into it more. I just want to make sure I don't lose this. This was from Woosits, and he said they're tuning the game for newer players. And this is something that we've kind of started to talk about. But the real thing is, when we talk about them tuning the game for newer players, I think that if that is the goal, it has not been a success at all. I think, on the other hand, kind of introducing and throwing complicated systems at new players that might turn them off, and then there's not as much there to keep them playing. I honestly don't feel like players are rewarded enough to be introduced as new players.
Blizzard,
would you agree?
Blizzard is going after the age-old I guess disastrous like perspective. I forgot who said this. I hope it wasn't Bill Cosby, but I think that it was. If you try to please everyone, you're going to end up pleasing no one, which actually, if you were, like, can I make that joke?
No, let's not do it.
let's not do that joke. But the point is, right, is that if you try to please everyone, you end up pleasing no one.
Look at the wholesome puppy.
That's a great, great dog. Really,
oh,
really
yeah. Good. We were talking about that.
Yeah, great dog. And you know, but the thing is, like, if you do content like that and you just try to make the game, who is your target audience? Everyone? Come on, man. Like, it's not everyone. Like, I think Blizzard trying to expand their target audience so much, they ended up diluting the game and creating a situation where they can never make everyone happy because they have so many different diverse groups of people playing the game that any decision will be met with a ton of criticism by a large percentage of the population. And Blizzard should have stuck with creating a game for a target audience rather than creating a game that anyone could play. Because the fact is that whenever Blizzard created WoW for a target audience, everyone played it. Not only anyone, but everyone played it. And now, whenever they're trying to make it for everyone, I think a lot less people do.
I just think that they're... I don't disagree with you at all. But it's so funny when I think about all the things that you would do to start fixing WoW. I think there are so many small changes that you could make that don't even seem like difficult changes that would have such a huge impact on mild things in the player psychology. Now, granted, I didn't even finish my psychology degree in college, but so I maybe don't know what I'm talking about completely. This is based off of my own experiences. And we've actually talked about potentially having a psychologist on the show to talk about it, because I do think that's something that we could really dive into. But when you look at just little psychological things, like the fact that loot doesn't actually drop off of bosses anymore with personal loot, I think that has a profound impact on how a player feels and how rewards actually affect the game. And I think there are so many systems. I think we could list like 100 of them right now if we tried. And those tiny little minuscule changes, if they came in, I think would make the game feel like a world again.
I think that's really kind of what a lot of people are trying to realize now. Right? I think a lot of people are like coming to now is that, because you ask people like, why did you stop playing WoW? And it's like, what don't you like about the game? What do you want changed? And it's like, okay, I want these things changed. And then you ask them, well, would you play the game if those things were changed? And they, many of them say, probably not. It's like, why is that? Why is it if you do that? I think that the reason is because WoW's decline isn't something where Blizzard added LFR and the game died that day and that was it. The fact is that it's been a death of a thousand cuts. There's been hundreds and thousands of things that they've done over the years that have just slowly eroded that player experience that so many people wanted to have. And it wasn't something that just happened overnight. Now, obviously, there were days where it was much more pronounced, but whenever a new patch came out, something big happened, like Titan Forging, Dungeon Finder, etc. But there was never, you can never really pinpoint it on any one point, because it's happened in so many different ways throughout the years. And like, I think that's really what the truth is. It's not like there's one thing that went wrong that made everybody quit.
This is actually like super valid points that you guys are bringing. We're actually someone that would ask the audience, would you guys like us to bring maybe a psychologist that specializes in the way that games provide rewards, or maybe add some developers that maybe worked in WoW previously? I think it'll be a really, really cool idea to analyze and deep dive the psychology of the game.
I think it's important.
Yeah, I would love to do that.
And I've talked to different game developers that have worked on a lot of projects that I think are fantastic, right? And I'm not going to mention any names right now. And I was kind of picking their brain, and they talk about, you know, how World of Warcraft really did reward players and the type of psychology behind it. I think it was called something saw reward system. It's basically a seesaw. And the idea to it is, when you look at old World of Warcraft, you would have huge dramatic power boosts where you'd be like, wow, I can really feel the fact that I'm more powerful after this reward. And then it would basically be like kind of easy to get there. Then it would be harder, and you'd work your way up, and then you would get in, you'd feel it again. You'd be like, oh, I'm accomplished. And then it would be a little bit harder, and it would be easy. So it actually changes like pacing over time.
It's like walking up a ramp versus walking upstairs.
Well, right now it's like jumping off a cliff, except the bottom of the cliff is good. Right. I feel like you kind of in WoW, you level, and you're slowly getting to the bottom of the cliff. You're losing power from 110 to max level. And then you get there and it goes, jump into the loot canyon. And you jump and you plummet to your ultimate death by being over rewarded. You get everything that you need. And then it's like, hey, dude, you could walk 4 steps over that way. It's going to take you 2 months because there's a pile of burning tar. We haven't taught you how to work hard at all. We just gave you everything for free. But now if you want that 1% to min-max your character, you have to work a jillion times harder when you haven't learned how to work in the system at all. The pacing's been terrible. Do you want to do it? And everyone's like, nah, wait till the next pass and I'll jump off the loot canyon again. Is that cool? And then you wait. Then you wait 3 months. Like, because that's how I feel right now. And, you know, people always joke around with me talking about PoE because I'm so positive about it. There's obviously plenty wrong with that game too. But the thing is a lot of the things that are wrong with that game, you know, it's just game stuff. It's me complaining because I died. And when I look at the reward system in PoE, min-maxing, like I already have on PoE over 200 hours played. And I'm still pretty new to the game, right? I already have over 200 hours played. Why? Because there's a steady increase in rewards. There's like a steady, and you can set goals. You can set your own goals. Like one of my things was for this league, I wanted to make sure I got a headhunter, right? And that's like a very expensive piece. It takes a lot of time to work towards it. There's no quick way around it. But the thing is because I set that goal, I could work towards it. A lot of the goal setting and work. Exactly. And the thing is with goal setting in World of Warcraft, a lot of the goal setting capabilities that you used to have are actually stripped away from the player base because it's such a linear progression. You if you follow the path, the path that's kind of thrown in front of you, like that's kind of the only way to play WoW now. And that wasn't how it felt before.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually a really, really important point is the fact that like a lot of these features and everything don't necessarily feel like you're able to set goals. And I think that's really one of the worst parts about these random rewards and the removal of vendors is that with vendors and bosses and things that had high loot drop chance tables, you would be able to like go in there and think, hey, there's a really good chance that I can get this item and that is my goal, rather than if I get this item, I need to get it plus 5 Titan Forge, or it has to have a socket for me to, for it to be better than my baseline item that I already have. And rewards don't really feel as impactful.
Dude, that stuff just feels like, let's be honest, I understand. I totally understand the idea of RNG coming on piece and getting a better piece of gear, how that is something that can entice a player base. But the way that the system works right now without a deterministic way to work towards it is absolute dog shit. Like, I don't understand how that's not something that changed. I'm going to bring up PoE one more time, and then I'm going to try not to talk about it for the rest of the night. It's easy to bring up a game that you are playing and enjoying and seeing some of the systems in it. I think World of Warcraft could learn leaps and bounds from not only Path of Exile, but a lot of other games that people are playing and actually enjoying right now. One of the things that's great about Path of Exile is there are a bunch of different, the way the gear drops, there's a huge amount of variance, right? There's a truckload of RNG that slaps you in the face every time that you play that game. But the thing is there are actually items that allow you to re-roll that RNG, and that's something that you can work towards to try to get the ideal piece. There is nothing in World of Warcraft that allows you to combat the RNG in that way. Yes, you can play the game more, but it's not a deterministic system at all, and I think that that's a huge problem. And I'm not just complaining about Titan Forging right now, because it goes a step further.
Yeah, I mean, you can't really compare like Path of Exile or any other ARPG, but let's just use Path of Exile for an example. You can't really compare their gear RNG to WoW's gear RNG, because those ARPGs are played by 99% of the population completely solo, and there's never a situation where somebody else's RNG is going to give them an advantage in a zero-sum environment over you like they would in WoW. And that's something that the gear RNG really does do in WoW. It's like, and I know Chinglish lost his raid spot in Nighthold because the other demon hunter had the ring and he didn't, and he just couldn't do the numbers that other guy could do because they were equally skilled, and that guy just had better gear because he got lucky. And that's not fun for anyone. I mean, like, it might be fun for the other guy, but it's not something that he earned. It's not something he's going to feel good about. And with Path of Exile also, like, you're right, you can use, different orbs and different items to reroll values and stats on your gear. And with WoW, the only thing that you can do is do it again. And I think that they do need to, if they want to continue with like this gear RNG stuff, which I think is a huge mistake, they need to do something to give players an alternative to just getting lucky. Because getting lucky doesn't, like, It's such a fleeting feeling. That's why people are addicted to gambling. It's because they do it once and they're like, okay, cool, let's do it again. Because they don't feel good. They don't feel fulfilled. That's the whole point of gambling. And whenever you think about it in the context of WoW, it makes sense of how like simple-minded and misguided the idea of creating these systems that resemble gambling casinos in the game are.
Well, the crazy thing is, too, is with gambling, you can actually do it more, right? Like, you can keep going to a certain degree. Obviously, you run out of money. But the thing is, get lucky, idiot. But the thing is when you talk about WoW, and I'm not saying that this is bad, but one of the things that has traditionally kind of in WoW time gated you, and I actually think that this was fine time gating, was the fact that you can only do certain things once a week. So when you have systems in that say, hey, play the game more to get additional chances, you go, I can't. I can't. I gotta sit here doing nothing for a week because I can't do anything anymore. You get one roll in your chest. And that's like, for a while, that was the only way as a certain type of player that you were going to get an Azerite piece. Have fun, idiot. Like, did you not get the piece you wanted? Are you going to sit there at a crappy power level forever, even though you're banging the highest level of content? It's so crazy. And people are bringing up different stuff in chat, like reforging never existed, stuff like that. I think that that goes right back to kind of how we started
exactly
this conversation.
The whole point, it's right? Like, they took it out of the game.
Yeah, but why not bring it back? Like, why is there such an aversion to bring back systems that the community feels like work?
Because they don't want to give players control. They want players to continue playing the game and their pre-constructed rails, and anybody who goes off the rails is punished. I mean, or not necessarily punished, but as I said, it's like a theme park now, and whenever you find a ride that you like, Blizzard shuts it down. Like, that's basically what's going on. Like, I know a lot of people, like, guys, do we have the Q&A, the tweet thing up?
We do. Let's
let them know. Because, like, this is, like, the idea that I had for today, and, like, we all had, was that we could make this episode more of a community-driven episode where we really sit down with you guys and talk about these issues. Because usually whenever we get to the Q&A, we only have time for maybe, at best, a half dozen questions. And yeah. There's a lot of people in here. Like, if you're watching a WoW podcast nowadays, you really care about the game.
Yeah.
And you're in good company. We all do. And we'd like to sit down with you guys and hear what you have to say. And that's what we want to do today. So, Hada, if you want to link the Twitter thing.
I've been posting
it. And guys, WoWhead's going to be helping us with this Q&A. So they go sure ahead and are. Jump on and do it on Twitter. And also, I saw this right now, and this is why I'm being so active in chat. I will take questions in chat as much as I can as well. It's just kind of tricky to do. Usually when I see one that I like, I kind of freeze the chat and then I go back.
It's
to
It's a lot more organized if you post it.
Yeah,
in the
so if you have a Twitter, use it on Twitter. But yeah, so Isle of Thunder was time gated and it was amazing. I'm fine with it. There are RNG and being time gated in World of Warcraft in the original game, not only just expansions, but in the original game, there were a lot of ways that the systems work. It's when you compound RNG and time gating onto stuff is when I feel like we have a lot of our pain points. Asmongold, do you feel that way? Because when you talk about the RNG of a loot table and there's the time gating of only being able to do it 1 week, it felt fine back in the day. Now when it's okay, there's the RNG of the loot table, it's not actually dropping off of the boss, and it can Titan Forge, it doesn't feel good anymore.
Well, that's because the chances of having an ultimate successful outcome are lowered. If I was going and I was doing Starfang in ICC, I knew there was an 8% chance for Deathbringer's Will to drop. And let's say there was like a 1% chance of me getting it, like total. Whereas now, you'd have like Heroic Mythic Warforged Deathbringer's Will with a socket. And if I got Deathbringer's Will, I had Deathbringer's Will, period. Mm-hmm. It's not like somebody else had a better version than me unless they did Heroic, which they obviously earned because they killed a harder version of the boss. There was only one version that I could get. And the chance of that positive outcome occurring was high enough that I felt fulfilled and motivated to go in there and try for it.
Yeah, a lot of people are bringing up Titan Residuum and basically being like, there is a deterministic way. And
well, and that's great. Like, we're happy. Like, I'm happy about Titan Residuum. Like, I'm very critical of Blizzard. I said the Residuum system is great. I'm very happy with it. It's a good idea. Blizzard made a good decision with making it because the sources are limited and you can only get Azerite gear from so many places per week. It effectively is a Valor cap. Great job, Blizzard. Awesome. Yeah. That's amazing. But that's only one aspect of the game. I can say, yes, this is awesome. Please do more of this. That's what I want to say. Please do more of this. There it is.
And
I want to emphasize something else. People, it's very hard really to get ideas across without speaking in absolutes. Time gating is not fundamentally bad. RNG is not fundamentally bad. The applications that Blizzard is using RNG and time gating in the game currently, I feel is bad. And that's the conversation to be had. Now, it's not about is time gating bad or is it good? There was time gating in Vanilla WoW. There was RNG in Vanilla WoW. Burning Crusade, your favorite expansion, had time gating and RNG in it. I can guarantee it. But that doesn't mean that you didn't still play it and love it and enjoy it every single day. But it's a more complicated conversation to have than remove time gating or remove RNG.
All right, we see a question here that is kind of a big one. I think we've talked about it in the previous episodes. Do you think a major decline for WoW subs is the lack of depth that most classes have and how static they feel to play?
I think that... Go ahead, Rich.
I definitely don't think it helps, but I will say, and I've mentioned this before, I said WoW's kind of an inverse sandwich, right? They're the two pieces of bread that actually make you go for the content, right? And that is going to be class design, and it's going to be the reward system. But I actually think the reward system is the bigger problem. There have been times in the past where we've seen class design not necessarily be in the best spot, but the reward system worked fine. And that was enough to keep players going. When you don't have both, that's when it's an even bigger problem. I think the major lashback to a lot of class design comes from the fact that we didn't really get anything new from the expansion. And I think the damage was really already done with that. I'm not saying it's the right thing. I definitely think that it's wrong and I don't think that it's good, but I think a lot of the damage is done right now. I think we lost a lot of those players already. And the thing is now is we're not losing more players because of class design. We're losing more players because of the reward system. I think we already lost everyone who got pissed off that their class honestly just feels worse than it did in Legion.
I think that a lot of times, like I've used this example before, is that you can look at the game as like the beach, right? And you can look at the class design as a window. And if the window is cracked, foggy, or, you know, in other ways, you can't see it, you're going to view the beach as not looking as beautiful as it could be. And I think that metaphor really describes the way that people see class design in WoW. I think some of the frustration and boredom that people have with Mythic Plus is indirectly because their classes might find or might feel less fun to play. I know for myself, for example, I don't do as much Mythic Plus now because I don't enjoy playing my warrior as Perrant really at all, because of the GCD changes, and they have changed that back, which is great. But at that point, I had already been playing for months. And the same with Arms Warriors as well. I don't find it as fun to play as I used to. And because of that, I'm not completing other content in the game, even though the content itself might still just be as compelling as it ever was. I think that's really the issue there, is that the class design and the classes that people play are the way that they interface and see and interact with the game. And yeah, if those classes are not good, then the players are going to many times say, oh, the game's not good. Of course. Yeah. How is that even weird?
Well, let's look at it. I like to use a dance analogy all the time, right? And yeah, the thing is that like your class design's 100% the dance that you're doing. And you look at like the raid tier and things like that, and that's kind of the music that you're dancing to. And right now we have, I think as far as encounter design is concerned, we got some pretty good music going, but you feel like you only know how to do the Macarena and it's a disaster. And I do think though that the problem is exacerbated by the fact of the reward system. And that's why I keep bringing it up, because class design in the past, a lot of the things that are interesting about class design, and I don't think it's the only thing, because I think Warrior in particular, it's very easy to point at what some of the problems were with Warrior. And I think it's easy to point to some of the problems with maybe Enhancement Shaman and things like that. But when you talk about class design being strong in the past, there were times when I only pressed Shadow Bolt as Warlock, but I was having a good time. Why? Because I knew which gear I could get to break my Shadow Bolt more. And that was something that was exciting. You look at certain times and you say, oh, this trinket allows me to change my rotation in this way. Tier sets allow me to change my rotation in this way. So many of the Azerite traits don't do that. You don't build your character. You don't create a character that has a rotation that changes that you... I think that's one of the things that makes WoW
feel empty. I think you don't build
empty.
Your character is a pretty powerful statement. I think it's true. Before, you were able to spend a lot more time building and making your character better, and your character's success was largely derived from your understanding of the game and the gear that you had acquired and earned. Whereas now, you know, your character's success is obviously better players do more damage more often, but it's less the case now, right? Because you have people that are able to get better gear by being lucky, and people that get better procs and everything like that. And again, I don't say that there shouldn't be any gear RNG or there should be no procs, but with how powerful they are now, it does muddy the waters between a good player and a great player, especially.
Yeah, I mean, more times than not, you're not going to have an outlaw rogue rolling a five buff every single time, right? The thing is, everybody has a proc. That's the problem with class designs. Everybody has a proc. Everybody has a builder. Everybody has a spender. Everybody has this cooldown on this time, this cooldown on another one. It's going to sync up with this trinket. I just know, even if I haven't played a class yet, and typically I was a guy who would play every class because it was so interesting to learn what they could do, what gear would synergize with them. Even without doing it right now, I know what I'm going to bind where. I know that my AoE ability is going to be on the six on my mouse. I know that the if there's a second AoE ability, where I'm going to put it. If there isn't, I know what I'm going to put there, because if they don't have a second AoE ability, they typically have X. Like, it's just so linear and so boring. It's just so obvious what's going to happen. And if you remember, this is like probably 30 Q&As ago, when Ian Hazzikostas was talking about class design, he said the main reason that we haven't gotten we didn't get new abilities was because they felt like it was moving to this area of homogenization, because they felt the need to give players, and I thought that this was an interesting thing to say, he said that the need to give players new abilities all the time was causing a lot of the homogenization problems, because it was like, okay, your level 15 trait is going to be the fact that, or is going to be a movement ability, right? And then everybody has a movement ability. Then you get to the next tier and it's going to be a defensive ability. The next one's going to be your AoE trait. Like, all of those things, I understood where he was coming from there. But the thing is at some point, when you do prune stuff down, when you try to break that homogenization, you need to be given us something as a player base. And
well, the thing is, like, what Ian was saying about the homogenization, or sorry, the bloat of abilities is completely true. But the difference between the bloat of abilities that we had in Mists of Pandaria and the amount of abilities that we have now, and then you look at Vanilla, is that in Mists of Pandaria, yeah, I think you could very easily make an argument that rotations were too complex for, like, most people. And, you know, maybe that argument might not be well received here, because most of the people here are obviously very invested players that, you know, care enough about the game to watch a podcast about it on Twitch. But for the majority of the player base, I would say that, yeah, probably the rotations were too complex. There were too many buttons that you had to do. And I do think there should be a conversation about, is the game too hard? Yes, I think there is a point where the game is too hard. It is too complex. It's not just, oh, the harder or the more complex the game is, the better it is. That being said, the situations that we have now are much weaker than I think we had even in Vanilla WoW. And in Vanilla WoW, we had more buttons generally than we even have now, but many of those buttons weren't necessarily used as rotational tools. You had these different abilities that gave your class flavor and made you feel like you were actually playing a hunter. And that, I think, is much more meaningful and better than not having anything at all.
Yeah, 100% agreed. Like, the back in the day, one of the key abilities, or one of the things that I remember the most about being a druid, was using Nature Swiftness combined with another ability. Nature Swiftness was a cooldown that allowed nature abilities to be casted instantly, and you could cast Nature Swiftness Cyclone, Nature Swiftness Hibernate, and you could do those clutch plays that were kind of niche in its own way. But at the same time, like, it would be a playmaker ability, and it would cause everybody to just kind of, like, be in awe about what the player just did. And for example, in a PvP scenario, it's the game feels, for me, pretty raw at the moment. Hopefully, Blizzard made it so now it's like they will build on this backbone. But at the same time, like, we need new abilities. We need things to be excited for. The fact that, I don't know, like, the fact that we had, like, Full Moon, for example, and now you have to sacrifice things in order to keep Full Moon. It's like things like that. It's just like, are just so detrimental to the game that just makes people kind of, like, bored with the class, or just, like, bring nothing new is definitely not good for the game.
I think as a Moonkin, you can definitely make an argument for that, right? And it's like, I can just say something, and this isn't even, like, the thing is that at a certain level, like, the way people feel does matter. And I'll say very clearly, I felt better playing my warrior in Legion than I do in BFA. It felt better to play. Now, why is that? I could go into why I think that is, But that is the ultimate outcome, that I felt better playing my character. So yes, I mean, to answer the question and circle back around, I do think that class design is a huge factor in how people engage with and how people enjoy the game. But I don't feel like class design is what defines the game as being successful or not successful. I think in points when the game is successful, class design is good, but there have been points where class design wasn't necessarily amazing. And like Burning Crusade, for example, with like rotations and all, and the game was still very successful. I think any time that we're going to see the game be successful again, however, will be at a time that class design is good.
Do you think that in order to make all these kind of like game altering decisions, like adding new abilities, do we have to wait for a new expansion? Or do you think they can just come mid expansion and say, all right, you know what? We'll give all these classes certain abilities.
I've said this before, and I think that it's going to take 2 to 3 expansions for them to undo, hypothetically, all of the bad decisions that they've made with the game. And my fear is that in the next expansion, it will take 3 to 4 instead of 1 to 2.
I kept kind of saying that it seemed like with this expansion that we were getting ourselves in an area where it wasn't going to be the case, where we had to wait till the end of the expansion for changes. I kept saying the success of Battle for Azeroth would be the ability to change on the fly. I think that there's still a glimmer of hope in that, in opening up the channel ways for communication and actually rapidly changing things. Not like the fact that Azerite's going to get completely taken out of the game essentially is great. Like, the fact that we are seeing changes like that coming in, like, when we get to the next raid tier, Azeroth is going to be drastically changed. If we keep seeing changes like that, yes, there's a lot of bad to undo in BFA, but I think that maybe we can come into the next expansion and speed up the timeline that you bring up rather than slow it down. I do want to bring this up, though, before I lose it. It's from Custodis and says, class guides simming is killing, class guides and simming killing the game. The player base is lazy and don't want to learn anything by themselves. Okay, and so this is an interesting topic.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there, right? I think the first thing is that the player base is lazy and doesn't want to learn anything themselves. I played this game for 12 years. That's never changed and never will. People are fucking stupid and they want to be stupid, right? It's not even that they're just dumb and it's like they want to learn better. No, they are aggressively stupid. They will play the game the way they want to play the game. And if you tell them any different, they will get mad. So yes, obviously players are lazy, but that is not something that has changed as an outcome of simulation craft or any sort of parsing or anything like min-maxing in class guides. There were class guides in Vanilla WoW. There were class guides in Burning Crusade. Was simming as much of a thing? No, it wasn't, but it was still a thing.
Our partners over at WoWhead literally... they have taken for Classic WoW all of the ThoughtBot comments and actually put them on the site. Like, there were resources. I will not disagree, though, with the fact that it has changed over time.
More prevalent,
like, you guys are watching a podcast right now about
they're more prevalent now because there are more internet power users now than there were in 2006. More people know how to interface with the internet, use the internet, and they have different ways of using the internet now than they used to back in 2006 and 2007, 2004, 2005. Of course, yeah. But I don't think that those tools have necessarily been a negative impact on the game, but I think you can make an argument for that. However, I don't think it's anything that we can prevent. I think it's something that would have happened on its own. And I can even use this as an example, is like Smash Brothers Melee. Now that the game has been out for so long, there are a lot of people that if you talk to them, they will only feel like unless you play Marth, Sheik, or Fox, or maybe Jigglypuff or something like that, you're just terrible at the game and you're an idiot who doesn't know anything. And obviously that's what happens whenever you have a competitive scene that does force those extremes. It's the way it goes. But at the same time, and like I'm talking like mostly some people are like, oh, not really, but these are just people that I've talked to, right? And like just in it's like passing. So
well, the
maybe,
fact that you have that in your mind at all means that information like that is out there, right?
Well yeah. I mean, like there's a reason why the meme Final Destination Fox Only No Items exists for Melee. Like, I mean, that's why. And that's just the outcome of being a game that has a large competitive fan base, is that those competitive behaviors are going to seep over into the larger player base. And like you could see that with like snapshotting dots, right? It's like very few people did that in Burning Crusade and Wrath, and nearly everybody did it, or many people did it in Mists of Pandaria.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was gonna ask Zach as a side question. What do you think about the whole snapshotting theory? Do you think it was good that Blizzard removed it? They didn't remove a layer of complexity, but
I didn't enjoy snapshotting, and I think that's like that. The conversation there is like it's a difference between like personal opinion and like there are some elements of gameplay that I feel make the game more complex, but they make the game more complex in a contrived and unfun way.
Okay.
Now, for me personally, I did not enjoy snapshotting. So I was glad that they removed snapshotting, but I can respect and understand somebody who disagrees with me. And I can use that same argument for the trinket from Throne of Thunder, that it would give you 100% crit chance. And as soon as you had the 100% crit chance buff, you would immediately go into demon form and put Curse of Doom or something like that on as many targets as possible because you wanted to have it snapshotted with 100% crit chance.
Yep. Yeah.
That makes classes more interesting, yes. But I didn't feel like that was fun to do. It felt like it was very frustrating, and it was like just a lot of pressure, I guess. And
I love snapshotting. I love snapshotting.
A lot of people.
I played also, classes that had snapshotting, and
I didn't. So who cares what I think?
Exactly.
I'm a warrior.
And that's the good thing about class design, right? Like,
yeah,
if you don't like it, play something else. There should be specs. And I can understand some arguments for against snapshotting, even as somebody who did like snapshotting. But I think that you should look at certain classes as WoW player and go, man, I hate that. I never want to play that. And you should look at other ones and say, that's for me. That is what I want to do. That is something that, and the other thing in the defense of snapshotting and systems like snapshotting, you know, one of the great things about snapshotting, if you were not playing on the top end of the game and you didn't know what snapshotting was, your class still felt fine. As a new player, you were still able to play Warlock without knowing what snapshotting was. And then you learned about it and your skill ceiling, the potential grew. And that was something where the game opened up. Now it's the opposite. Now it's learn what Azerite is. Learn that you should do this many islands a week. Learn that you should do this amount of mythics a week. Learn that you should do LFR to be able to get this resource to craft this gear to then do another raid tier that's insignificant and then do another raid. And you look at the older versions of the game and you go, wait, the game was so simple. It was like level up to 60. Get blues instead of greens. Now try to get epics. And then when you got to that top level, it was like, holy shit, this stuff is nuts. This is nuts. Wait, I can do what? And it's the opposite now. Any new player that is coming in is completely overburdened. And then any player who has been playing for a long time is completely bored. So it doesn't attract new players, in my opinion. And it doesn't keep the old ones happy. So who exactly are you trying to reach with the current iteration of the game? And I think that's my biggest problem.
That goes back to the conversation about making the target audience everyone. It's a silly, silly, silly thing to do. And it's obviously not working. But yeah, I totally agree. I mean, like, the whole thing is like complexity and everything like that should be a goal, but it doesn't always have to be like the driving factor. Like, not everything that's complex isn't good. Like, being complex is not synonymous with being good.
Yeah, I would agree with that. There is good stuff that's complicated, and there's also good stuff that's very, very easy, right? And guys, if you want to be asking us questions right now, you can do it on the tweet if you got a Twitter, or you can also ask us right here in chat. I am paying attention right now and trying to make sure that we get all of them answered.
Well, let's go to another one. I think we've pretty much gone into that.
Before we end the show, I have an announcement to make. A lot of people have been requesting this feature from us, and I finally was able to get through to someone and get it done. So in the next coming weeks, AllCraft will also be available on Spotify. So, people that have been asking me.
I had no idea.
So people have been asking me nonstop, like, "Oh, I would love to hear you guys during my commute. I would love to hear you guys during traffic." We got you, boys. It's coming.
Yep.
I literally thought that Ian was coming on the. This is exciting, though. This is exciting.
No, we're not going to announce that until next week.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. I was like, I have an announcement. It's finally happening. I was like, no way, dude. Like, no. But yeah, guys, I feel like one of the things that I get asked most often about the show is like, when is it going to be able to be downloaded or streamed on just an audio platform? And the answer is now. Thank you, Alan, for getting all of that together. That is very, very exciting. Ian, when?
Good question.
Good question, boys.
Now it's on Spotify. Ian, what if you on Spotify?
Let us know, man.
Guys, thank you for the first episode of 2019. It was awesome to just kind of sit down with the folks that got this show started, and to sit down with all of you who have been here throughout all of last year and the very beginning of the show. Thank you for all of your questions. Thank you for still supporting the show, and thank you for trying to make the game great again. Asmongold and Hotted, I love you both very much, and all of you, we'll see you next week for another episode of AllCraft.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, and as always, it's been a pleasure, and here's to many more in 2019.
Make WoW great again. Peace out.
Peace. Oh, that's hot. That's hot.